Hello friends, are you puzzled on seeing flow plots? Difficulty in understanding words like forward scatter, side scatter or CD markers? Today we will be discussing basics of flow cytometry, where we will cover everything from principle of this technique to light scatter and characteristics of normal cells. So let's begin. Flow cytometry plays a very important role in diagnosis, subclassification and post-treatment monitoring of blood cancers or leukemias. Multi-parameter flow cytometry can analyze multiple markers on cells simultaneously to establish a lineage in acute leukemias. Individual cells can be analyzed one by one for parameters such as number, size, markers, which are important for establishing the diagnosis. Flow cytometry data is analyzed in depth by specific flow cytometry software programs. So in today's video, we will learn about basics of flow cytometry. What are the different key components of a flow cytometer? How does a flow cytometer analyze the number, size and markers on the cells? Flow cytometry principles and how to read the flow plots. Welcome back to Pathogenesis, where we understand the disease. If you are here for the first time, kindly subscribe. Stick with us till the end of the video to understand the basics and principles of flow cytometry. We split the term flow cytometry into three parts. Flow means in motion, cyto means cells, and metry stands to measure. So flow cytometry is the measurement of numerous cell properties as the cells move in a single file in a fluid column while being interrupted by a beam of light. Our target in flow cytometry is evaluation of properties of single cells. Hydrodynamic focusing is the key to this. An overview of flow cytometry. Cells in suspension flow in a single file past a focused laser where they scatter light and emit fluorescence. Emitted fluorescent light is then filtered by lenses and collected on receptors, which convert them to digitalized values in the form of plots. What are components of a flow cytometer? Flow cytometer contains different components, including fluidics that move the cell in sample into the flow cytometer, optics which emit and gather the light with the help of detectors, and a computer system to acquire the data in the form that can be analyzed by a researcher. So let's begin with fluidics. The cells need to flow one by one into the cytometer to do single cell analysis, which is accomplished through a pressurized laminar flow system. Teeth tank is a reservoir with isotonic fluid, which under pressure is forced into a tubing, which delivers it to the flow cell. Sample is also injected into the flow cell at variable pressure. Sample fluid flows in a central core that does not mix with sheath fluid. The pressure of the sheath stream hydrodynamically aligns the cells so that they are presented in a single file to the light beam. The introduction of a large volume of fluid into a small volume in such way that it is focused along an axis is called hydrodynamic focusing. Optics consist of light sources, lenses, and filters. Light source in all flow cytometry instruments are lasers. Lasers provide a single wavelength of light which is coherent. They provide the energy to excite fluorochromes of interest and help to create a stable and reliable signal. Nearly all instruments are fitted with an argon laser which gives blue light at 488 nanometers. Second or third laser may also be there, which can be helium neon red light at 633 nanometer or a helium cadmium UV at 325 nanometer. The most commonly used are three lasers, that is 405 nanometer violet, 488 nanometer blue and 633 nanometer red. But in today's multi-parameter flow cytometers, we can have even more lasers and around 10 to 14 markers can be analyzed at a time. Before the laser beams reach the sample stream, cross-cylindrical lenses focus the beams. Focusing keeps the beam perpendicular to the sample stream flow while making the beam small enough to illuminate only one cell at a time. The first lens controls the width of the beam, the second height. The resulting elliptical beam is focused on the sensing area of the flow cell. When light from a laser interrogates a cell, that cell scatters light in all directions. The scattered light can travel from the interrogation point down a path to a detector. Interrogation point is the point at which light intersects the cells inside the flow cell. At this point, two events take place: light scattering and emission of fluorescent light. Light that is scattered in the forward direction, that is along the same axis in which the laser is traveling, is detected in the forward scatter channel. The light detected at 90 degrees is called the side scatter. At the same time, antibodies bound to fluorochromes are excited by the beam of the light and emit fluorescent light in the direction of the side scatter. Once the sample has been placed in the flow cytometer, the machine will suck up the sample, mix the sample into a stream of saline solution in cytometer and lead the cell suspension through a narrowing channel, causing the cells to form a single file line before the cells pass through the laser at the interrogation point. Each cell moves across the laser beam, allowing each cell within the sample to be individually analyzed. As each cell passes through the laser beam will be scattered in multiple directions. The amount of forward scattered light for each cell is detected by detector on the far side of the cells from the laser and is detected in the forward scatter channel. As we can see, the larger the cells, it is scattering more light and smaller cells are deflecting less light. The detector converts the scattered light into a voltage pulse which is directly proportional to the amount of forward scattered light. The computer converts these data into a histogram plot with the amount of forward scattered light on the x-axis and the number of cells on the y-axis to generate a histogram. Forward scatter is proportional to the size of the cell and separates live cells from the dead cells. The amount of side scattered light is detected by a detector located perpendicular to the path of the laser beam. Side scatter is proportional to the shape and internal complexity of the cell. Just like with forward scattered light, the flow cytometer converts the detected side scattered light into a voltage pulse, which is directly proportional to the amount of side scattered light. Intensity of this signal is proportional to the amount of cytosolic structures in the cells, such as granules, cell inclusions, vacuoles. Why to look at forward scatter versus side scatter? Since forward scatter analyzes size and side scatter the internal structure, by analyzing them together, we can understand a cell's size, shape, and complexity. In addition, the analysis of the forward and side scatter data can also help us to divide the heterogeneous population of cells into individual populations with varying size, shape, and complexity. This capability of analyzing multiple populations within a sample is the immense strength of the flow cytometry technique. Granulocytes are the largest cells with many granules and hence have both forward and side scatter high. Debris composed mainly of RBCs are small cells and are anuclear, hence have a very low of both side scatter and forward scatter. Lymphocytes have no granules or cytoplasmic complexity, hence have low side scatter. Monocytes are larger than lymphocytes and have nuclear foldings and cytoplasmic granules, causing a higher forward scatter and side scatter. Fluorescence. A flow cytometer can also detect emitted fluorescent light from excited fluorescent molecules. Fluorescence is the property of certain substances by which they absorb light at a certain wavelength and then emit light at a longer wavelength. These substances are called fluorochromes. FITC, PE, ECD, PC5, APC, PER-CP are the common fluorochromes which are used in flow cytometry. As the laser interrogates the cell, fluorochromes on or in the cell may absorb some of the light and become excited. As these fluorochromes leave their excited state, they release energy in the form of a photon with a specific wavelength, longer than the excitation wavelength. These photons pass through the collection lens and are split and steered down specific channels with the use of filters. Let's learn with an example. A sample has few cells which we do not target and others which we want to analyze. CD7 positive cells and CD19 positive cells. In flow cytometry, we mark the antibodies against CD19 and CD7 with fluorochromes, like yellow and blue in this case. During sample preparation, they bind with CD19 and CD7 positive cells and indicate the presence of these cells by the light emitted by the fluorochrome, which is directed along a path with emission filters that allow for detection of multiple different fluorophores emitting light in a cell. Flow cytometer can detect the presence of a fluorophore and can also quantify the relative amount of a fluorophore within a cell. A flow cytometer can detect from 2 to 3 to up to 18 different colors at a time. Now coming to filters. Many wavelengths of light will be scattered from a cell. We need a way to split these lights into its specific wavelength in order to detect them independently. This is done with the help of filters. Optical filters are designed such that they absorb or reflect some wavelength of light while transmitting the other. Three types of filters are generally used: long pass filter, short pass filter, and band pass filter. Long pass filters transmit all wavelengths greater than the specified wavelength. For example, 500 LP will transmit all wavelengths greater than 500 nanometer. Short pass filters transmits all wavelength less than specified wavelength. For example, 600 SP will transmit all wavelength less than 600 nanometer. A band pass filter transmits a specific band of wavelength. For example, 550 by 20 BP filter will transmit wavelengths of lights between 540 nanometer and 560 nanometer. Dichroic filters can be a long pass or short pass filter. They are placed at a 45 degree angle to the incident light. Part of it is reflected at 90 degree to the incident light, and part of the light is transmitted and continues. Now coming to detectors. There are two main types of photodetectors used in flow cytometry. Photodiodes, which are used for strong signals when saturation is a potential problem. For example, a forward scatter detector. Photomultiplier tubes or PMT is more sensitive than a photodiode. A PMT is used for detecting small amounts of fluorescence emitted from the fluorochromes. Photodetectors usually have a band pass filter in front of them to only allow a specific bandwidth of light to reach it. Therefore, each detector has a range of light it can detect once a filter has been placed in front of it. Here is an example of how these filters function. To separate scatter and multiple fluorescence wavelengths simultaneously from each cell, design of a multi-channel layout must consider spectral properties of the fluorochromes used and appropriate positioning of the filters. Laser falls on the cell and light is scattered. Like in this case, we see four colors of light being generated. The first filter, a dichroic filter, allows all lights to pass except blue, which is then passed onto the band pass filter, allowing only blue light to pass, which is detected by the detector. The second filter filters out green light, and the third filter yellow light. In this way, the light scattered by laser from the cells is split by different filters and aids in detection. Electronics. Detectors basically collect photons of light and convert them to current. The electronics must process these light signals and convert the current to a digitalized value that the computer can represent as a graph. Various software such as Kaluza, CellQuest, Flowzo, WinMDI, FCS Express, etc. aid in analysis of these flow cytometry files. Data presentation. The data can be presented in the form of a single color histogram, which plots fluorescence intensity versus count, or two color dot plot. Plotting fluorescence intensity of parameter 1 versus fluorescence intensity of parameter 2 on x and y axis respectively. Also used are two color contour plots, which represent the same data as two color dot plot but in a different way. Concentric rings form around the population. The denser the population, the closer the rings are to each other. Two color density plots marks areas of higher density with different color than other areas. Side scatter versus any one parameter histogram shows that the dimmer expression of the fluorescence intensity in a subpopulation of cells is taken as negative and a brighter expression as positive. Let's see how the two color histogram is analyzed. On x axis, FITC fluorescence is exhibited, and on y axis, P fluorescence is exhibited. So we can analyze the percentage and characteristics of double positive population, single positive FITC population, single positive PE population, and negative population. Gating is used to isolate a subset of cells on a plot and set a region on histogram. It allows the ability to look at parameters specific to only that subset. Compensation. Fluorochromes typically fluoresce over a large part of spectrum, 100 nanometer or more. This graph shows emission wavelength of few commonly used fluorochromes. As we can see that there is an overlap among these emission wavelengths. Depending on filter arrangement, a detector which detects light on the basis of wavelength may hence detect some fluorescence from more than one fluorochromes, which is referred to as bleed over. We need to compensate for this bleed over so that one detector reports signal from only one fluorochrome. Now coming to CD45 versus side scatter plot. Based on all the knowledge we have gained so far, we can now proceed to learn the standard plot of flow cytometry. CD45 versus side scatter plot gives us a lot of information about types of cells among the heterogeneous population of cells. RBCs and debris do not have CD45 on their surface and are of small sizes. Lymphocytes and monocytes show bright antigenic expression of CD45 and have low side scatter. Granulocytes also show moderate expression of CD45 and have a high side scatter. The most important is the blast window. Blasts have moderate to dim expression of CD45 and have a low side scatter. Apart from diagnosing leukemias and hematological malignancies, there are few other clinical applications of flow cytometry, which include identifying normal hematopoiesis to define the immunophenotypic signature, staging of lymphomas, minimal residual disease detection, platelet function analysis, studying erythropoiesis and red cell disorders, study of intracellular cytokines, MSC complex analysis, analysis of phagocytosis, cell cycle and detection of apoptosis. So guys, that's all for today. Hope you were able to understand the basics of flow cytometry. In next video, we will be discussing flow cytometry on normal hematopoiesis, including normal myeloid T and B cell differentiation. This is essential before we proceed towards flow cytometric analysis of leukemias and lymphomas in our coming videos. Thank you for listening, and if you like our videos, please press the like button and don't forget to subscribe so that you don't miss updates about our next videos. Thank you.